welcome to episode 98 of the Waste of Web Space podcast.
Starring
Jimbo.
And Fisher.
Surprised we remembered the intro, considering how long it's been since we last broadcast. But hello, if you are listening to us right now, hello. Hello if you're listening and watching live. Hello if you're listening or watching not live. Maybe in your car, maybe in the bath, maybe in bed. Or wherever you are.
Are those two separate events, in the car, in the bath?
Yeah.
Because you said them quite close together to make it sound like you might be both in a car and in a bath, which is probably not a very good recipe for, you know, how to drive, really, is it?
Have you not heard of a car bath?
I haven't, no. Is that like the beds that you can get when you were younger? You used to have sort of a bed that was like a car or a football net or that sort of stuff that people used to have when kids used to have them then?
I know what you mean, but to be honest, I just completely made that up. Anyway, on to the episode title then. Let's not waste any more time. Our episode is titled Holiday Controversy because of Boris Johnson's holiday that he's been investigated for, isn't he?
We'll come on to it probably later on in terms of he seems to have just announced some relaxation to the lockdown rules on the same day that he's also getting investigated for how a holiday was funded in Christmas 2019, I think.
Yeah, so just before the pandemic.
Yeah,
at least they got a last holiday in there, though. Good timing, yeah. Bojo.
At Christmas time, yeah. I mean, what between Christmas and New Year, I think he went to the Caribbean islands. Was it allegedly paid for at the time, or allegedly there was some kind of arrangement with the person who owns phones
Car phone warehouse.
And
if you say phones for you, you can't do it without going phones for you.
Yeah.
But it's car phone warehouse. There, I think phones for you are now defunct, I think.
Yes, but there was still someone who once owned them, so he's still alive as far as I'm aware.
Okay. Anyway, are you ready for your song?
Let's play the song.
So here it is, Holiday Controversy. It's a Madonna, a cover of Madonna. Okay, here we go. Holiday Controversy. Holiday Controversy. Boris took a holiday, but no one sure who paid. He took his fiancée, but who paid? So did he break the code of the parliamentary regulations? He went across the world to a sunny Caribbean nation. Was it a Tory donor, or was it the taxpayer? Boris is under pressure after his Caribbean weather. Who paid for the holiday? Boris took a holiday, but no one sure who paid. He took his fiancée, but who paid? There you go. Okay, so yeah, there you go. That you can get the gist, don't you? Because I think it's not necessarily that the taxpayer paid if it wasn't the Tory donor, but it's the fact that what was the Tory donor given in return for the holiday, which obviously, if it is a lucrative contract for, you know, like they were giving out these contracts willy-nilly to the friends and stuff like that, then in effect it is sort of taxpayers' money, isn't it? Because it was a government sort of contract.
Sorry, Jimbo, I'm just hearing that he was given a lucrative contract. He was given 8 gigabytes of data on a 24-month contract for only £35 a month.
That is a bargain.
Well done.
Brilliant.
Fantastic.
Yeah. Oh, I mean, you can't blame him then, can you? What about the roaming? Maybe just waive the roaming charges.
Maybe. Who knows? I think as we mentioned on the last podcast, where it was mentioned about Boris Johnson and his wallpaper and redecorating his flat. I think, did we mention it on the last podcast? I can't remember, actually. It was that long ago. But was it still bubbling there? It started?
Was it that? Was it something else? I mean, it's also been up today that he owes the court some money as well, doesn't he, Boris Johnson?
Apparently he's got a county court judgment against him for about £500, which, whether or not it's actually a genuine debt that he owes or it's just someone who's taking the piss out of him. No one's quite sure just yet. but yeah, I think in general, we mentioned about the flat, and I don't really care who Harry's flat gets funded. But, well, I shouldn't care about it. But the reason I do care about it is because we've got a Prime Minister who gives out PPE contracts to anyone and everyone. So I am a bit more bothered about it. So the way the Tory politicians say that people don't care about it, I think what they actually mean is we shouldn't care about it. But because of the backstory and so many things that have happened, we actually do care about it.
They're calling it the sleaze files, aren't they?
Yeah, and there's just so many of it. It's hard to hard to keep track, unfortunately. I mean, perhaps that's the way. Never be pinned down to one bit of bad behaviour by having
just
so
loads.
Many bad bits of behaviour.
Exactly.
You can't pin down to one thing.
Anyway, should we do some breaking news?
Let's do breaking news.
Do you want to go first, Fisher, or shall I?
Can do. Well, should we do a joint one first, which is that we, together, well, not quite together, we both participate in a virtual cocktail night, didn't we?
Well, I was wondering what that was going to be about then, because it was so long ago. But yeah, we did. Virtual cocktail night, Sheffield Distillery, the second one we've both done together. You'll be happy because you got a mention this time as a part of the Waste of Web Space podcast, whereas you were overlooked last time, weren't you, Fisher?
Yeah. For an inferior podcast.
Yeah.
They said,
yeah, we're really sorry about last time. We gave Jimbo a shout out for his Ale and Audio podcast, but we've completely forgot about the other podcast, The Waste of Web Space, hosted by Jimbo and his co-presenter, William Shakespeare. Chris Fisher.
my hair, I can confirm, is still getting a bit out of control. I've still not had it cut yet.
I thought this was going to be breaking news today. I thought breaking news today is surely that Fisher's hair's been sorted.
No, I'm continuing with it with these long, luscious, long locks, and who knows how long they're going to be here for.
You're well protected should anything fall on your head.
Yeah, I mean, I'll get to something else that I'm doing shortly and my hair and sort of how that functions within it. But yeah, I think I'm quite enjoying having the longer hair. It's all right, I'm getting used to it. I say it's not going to stay forever, obviously, but there we go. So yes, we took part in the Sheffield Distillery cocktail night. It was very good, really enjoyed it. How about yourself?
Yeah, really good. As always, Karen and Paul, who were sort of running the show on screen, absolutely brilliant as always. Probably the best presenters, I think, in Chapeltown, arguably. When it comes to broadcasting, what do you think, Fisher?
I think a fantastic double act. I mean, I don't know where they get their inspiration from, really.
But also, yeah, well done to those behind the scenes as well, because they have a lot. We don't get that. We don't get the technical support, though, do we, that Paul and Karen get?
Yeah. We don't have Simon Cooper doing that. I mean, as I say, it was a bit confusing the first one I went on, because you're expecting sort of something that says Sheffield Distillery, all that. It says underneath it, Simon Cooper. I think it's Simon Cooper. Turns out he's sort of an expert in terms of doing camera work and Zoom and what have you.
Yeah, well done to them all, though, because they all did a great job, a great night again. I was a fan of the strawberry crush, which mainly because I put so much effort into crushing those strawberries.
Yeah, I can't particularly remember.
Did you have too many?
I preferred the, too many strawberries. I was just high on sugar come the end of it. I was bouncing off the walls. I quite enjoyed the orange St. Clement's one. I thought it was quite nice.
Yeah.
I can't remember the precise name of
it. Which is one of the award-winning gins, isn't it, as well? The St. Clement's gin.
Without being funny, don't we say that about all of their gins? Which is probably just goes to show the sheer high quality of the gins that they've got. But the amount of times, award-winning. Tell you one thing, Jimbo. You never hear us banging on about our awards, do you?
No, you don't.
No.
Well, mainly because we haven't got any. In fact, we do have an award coming up today, actually. Unfortunately, it's not for you, it's not anything to do with you.
Again.
But it was good.
What did amuse me slightly is that they promoted the podcast, and my brother-in-law was also on the Zoom, and he wrote in the comments, basically, he put podcast equals waste of web space. So I think anyone reading that will probably have found it fairly insulting, just basically slagged our podcast off as opposed to that's the name of the podcast.
Yeah.
But of course, things took a slightly unusual turn, didn't they?
Yeah.
When at last bit where they said, has anyone got any questions? And I doorstopped a member of the... someone who was just innocently enjoying a cocktail making evening, and they got questioned by me. And I said, bear in mind, I've had a few cocktails at this point. I said, is Liz there? Yeah, Liz, who's on this podcast? Who's on this Zoom? And it was a girl who we met on one occasion, or may have met her before, but specifically met her on one occasion when we appeared on the news.
Yeah.
Talking about Northern Rail and how bad their service was. and we sort of noticed she was on there.
So, this is a time when I did a tweet because I was really angry at Northern Rail again. And Danny Savage, BBC reporter, got in touch with me and said, can I come and interview you, Jimbo, at the train station one morning? So my interview was hijacked by Chris Fisher. And then Chris Fisher's interview was hijacked by Lizzie, weren't it?
Yeah. I think her name is actually Elizabeth Taylor, but not that one. And she was talking about how many people you can get stuck in a train toilet. And she made it onto the news. It was a bit strange on that interview because you were like for it and I was against it. So we ended up sort of arguing with each other, really, and been portrayed as not being on the same side, which was a bit weird. That was the first time we'd seen us. I'd literally never seen her since then because I tended to get an early train. So I've not seen that person at all since then until she popped up on the virtual cocktail making night. So we asked if she'd seen the interview, which turned out she actually had. So good on her.
Good. Well, yeah, and she recognises as well, I think.
Eventually. Yeah.
Yeah. After a bit of prodding and poking and so on.
Yeah.
So is that all your breaking news for now? Oh no, you've got another one, haven't you?
Yeah. I've got some other bits of breaking news. So I'm currently part of a challenge at work.
Is it grow your hair as long as you can?
It's not grow hair as long as you can.
Is it wear as many women's clothes on a podcast as you can?
No, this is my own again, actually. So men's cardigan, I think you'll find.
Okay.
Size tan. So, yeah, we're doing a walking challenge. We're in teams of seven, I think, and we've got to basically record our steps for the two-week period. It's to...
So like 5, 6, 7, 8, my boots, scootin' baby is drive. That you're going to have to do a few cover versions and so on.
Pretty much, yeah, yeah.
Recording your steps.
Do that. Better the Devil, you know.
Yeah.
A Deeper Shade of Blue, is that a step song? Mm-hmm. Yeah. Or Brighter Shade of Pale, can't remember.
Obviously there's Lisa Scott Lee... H, who turned out to be in Call of Duty. Uncredited part, obviously. But yeah. I can't remember any of those.
Did you say Call of Duty then, by the way?
Line of Duty,
yeah. Sorry.
Is Call of Duty the one where you shoot each other on an actual game?
Yeah, I think Call of Duty is the game, right. Yeah. Line of Duty is a TV program that I don't watch. I don't play the game, I don't watch the program, so people are talking about
it. Well, I do watch the program, still managed to call it something else, but never mind.
Yeah, never mind. So, doing the walking challenge, I'm currently... I did 23,500 steps first day, and on the second day, managed about 15,500. I've gone to over 16,000 steps today, so I'm doing all right. I think I'm doing okay. I think sort of for a lot of people, they try and just get to 10,000, but
if you started on 23,000, then you went to... 16,000. It sounds like you're going downhill.
Hey. Yeah, I would have got more when I did 16,000, but I started walking backwards at some point, so it started taking the steps off.
Right, okay. Yeah.
But, it's all good fun. We're doing it to promote National Mental Health Week, so we're doing a physical challenge, as you do. Mm-hmm. And this is the best bit about this. You know, we're trying to promote this and trying to encourage people to sort of get outside, enjoy the fresh air, get some exercise. Hopefully, you know, movement is medicine, you know, your health is your wealth and all that sort of stuff. And as you walk around, you'll sort of feel better and things will just in general be, you know, you can sort of de-stress while you're walking around. And also on this sort of news I've got sent around to people while they were talking about National Mental Health Week and going out and walking, they said also a great way to pass the time whilst walking is listen to a podcast.
Oh, brilliant. So we got we've got a little bit of a PR, have we?
So yeah, well, I mean, I don't want to say anything, but I helped to sort of last year when we sort of got into lockdown. I helped to create this newsletter and sort of set the template up and sort of do the first drafts of the newsletter and all this sort of stuff.
I like where this is going. I like this is going.
Yep. And obviously, we've done 97 episodes of our podcast over a period of what? 7, 8 years, like that.
Yeah, but forget the first, you know, we had a big gap, so
yeah,
you might as well think last 3 years, you know, but yeah.
Yeah, last year alone, we produced, what, 35, 36 podcasts, and we worked out that we've maybe done about 48 hours of podcasting, and what have you.
Award winning, obviously me, not you, nothing to do with podcasting, but yeah.
So, we didn't get a mention, unfortunately. Never mind.
So we didn't get a mention.
We didn't get a mention.
So what did they mention?
Louis Theroux's grounded. The Mother Podcast with Zoe Blakesley, Positive People Podcast, the Feel Better, Live More Podcast, the Josh Whitaker and Rob Beckett Lockdown Parenting Hell.
So you're saying we didn't make a list of podcasts that might make you feel better?
Exactly.
All people have to do is watch the live version, look at your hair, and they instantly feel better about themselves.
I don't know why I'm advertising some of these other podcasts. The Goop Podcast.
Stop it.
Gossip Mongers. The Art of Manliness Podcast. Oh, no.
Right, I've turned him down. Okay, I can't hear you anymore. Right, now I best put him up because he carries us, really. So, yeah. Anyway, so, Fisher.
So, what's your breaking news, anyway?
My breaking news. I put a roof on my pergola.
Really?
A permanent roof.
A pergola?
It was... So you visited the Ale and Audio Pub Shed, and it had a tarpaulin roof, so it was not particularly great in the rain, and you know we've had a lot of rain recently, so my dad gave me some ideas and gave me some tips and gave me the tools and everything, and I created a slightly sloped roof on top of the pergola, and underneath it I have put imitation vine as well, so it's got that kind of botanist sort of feel to it, if you've ever been somewhere like the botanist. Pub sort of things. It's looking good. And I went to Whitby in a glamping pod with my mum, and took Ada as well, of course. And yeah, it was really well. Not my mum was in a cottage, and I was in the glamping pod because obviously not allowed to share accommodation and stuff like that. So you need to have your own accommodation. You couldn't have mixed people from the same family at the minute in accommodation and so on. So there I am in the glamping pub, which was great. It was like when people think glamping, they think of a posh tent, but this was more like a wooden sort of, posh looking shaped shed thing, like curved sort of thing, like almost like a bit like a bomb shelter, but not metal, more like made out of wood. Yeah. So a little cabin. And they had in there things like, it was pretty good, because they had like things like a microwave, obviously the beds were in there, just your simple facilities, a sofa, a TV, a kettle, but no toilet.
No toilet?
Yeah, a kettle, but no toilet. Really boils my piss. But anyway.
I was just about to say exactly the same thing. So,
I'd have been really annoyed. So there you go. That's my breaking news. Yeah, we avoided all the rain. Got pretty decent weather. Aidan nearly got hit by a goat. I got that on camera. I'm happy with that. I'm going to wait till Lisa Riley's back on asking for £250 for it or whatever. Does she do that anymore? Probably not. Is it Ariel? I don't know. There you go. That's what I've been up to.
Good stuff. Pleased to hear it. I mean, obviously, sad to hear that Aidan nearly got eaten by a goat. Sounds like a bit of a silly billy.
Hey!
But there we go. Are we going to have our beers?
We are. Let's move on. So obviously, being in Whitby, you've been to Whitby before, and you've come back to the podcast with a beer from Whitby, haven't you? I didn't bother going up those steps, so I've just got one from Sheffield, which is a possibly featured on this podcast before. I've certainly had it before, and it's certainly been on my Instagram, Ale and Audio Instagram account before. Just a little bit of promotion there, Ale and Audio. There's another podcast called Ale and Audio and an Instagram account called Ale and Audio. But I don't like to do too much personal promotion on this Waste of Web Space podcast.
Can't build notes, you're just behind you. You've got an advertisement for your business as well, haven't you, Jimbo?
Oh, I forgot to take that down, haven't I?
What's the chance of
what
that?
What am I like? Anyway, so it's a hazy IPA, DDH, double dry hopped beer from, it's 6%, and it's from one of my favourite Sheffield breweries, the brand new, well, sort of brand new, is in, you know, kind of started up during the pandemic. They're doing really well for themselves, Little Mesters. And I've had this before, and I really like it. And I can't remember if I've had it on this podcast or I've just had it separately before, but I will pour it, show you the colour of it as well, because it's a really good drink, this one. And I think you can actually get it in mini kegs as well. So there you go.
I'm just sending a message to someone about trying to get some beers from Southampton. Someone said I'm going to Southampton and working down there a bit, so please contact me about getting some beers from Southampton. So I'm literally just sending a message now.
Well, so if it's not on Portsmouth,
obviously. Or Portsmouth. I mean, I got some from the Isle of Wight last year. I've got some of this. Adnams Southwold Bitter,
mm-hmm.
which I presume is it Suffolk as opposed to Norfolk, I think. Adnams.
Yeah, I've had their ghost shit before.
All right, okay. Jack Brand, Southwold Bitter, been made since 1912. Same year Titanic sank. I don't know if that's connected at all. I presume it probably isn't, I guess. I don't quite know why I've particularly got this bottle. I think I might have just picked it up from a shop I was in because it was a bit of a... It was on its own. It's a bit strange to have one single bottle because I can't quite remember exactly where it's from. It is Southwold, yes, it's Suffolk. So it's got an IP postcode, so it's near Ipswich. Although I think last time I actually had some of this, I was in Norfolk, as it so happens. So I think I don't know if they're friendly or whether they're rivals, Norfolk and Suffolk. I don't know if it's like Yorkshire and Lancashire. I'm going to pour it out, and it's the bitter, so it's a bit slightly darker brown in its colour and texture. Say texture, I mean colour, really, don't I?
Yeah.
Can you remember back in the days when we only used to have like half of these bottles each?
Mm.
But now we're on to a full bottle.
Yeah.
Got a little bit too much head on that. I'm not sure what yours tastes like, Jimbo. Yeah, I'm sick of this.
I might have to drink out of the can while I let it settle. But Sam, I've had mine before. I really like it. It's a strong one, obviously.
That's quite.
But it's quite.
It's all right. I mean, it's not the most amazing pint of bitter I've ever had. I mean, you can tell it's not a good pint of bitter. It doesn't say the word best bitter in front of it, so that's always a giveaway. Right. So.
Okay.
Yeah.
Everyone calls it that, don't they?
Yeah. So these don't. I'll be honest. I'm not overly impressed with it.
Mm.
But
might have a cup of best coffee after this.
Yeah.
Or even a best glass of water or something. Anyway, should we move on?
Yes, let's move on to the next part of the show.
It's my show and tell, for sure. And for my show and tell this week, as I've kind of already briefly mentioned, I've got a bit more breaking news. I have a new certificate in front of me, which I obviously, because I will ruin my show and tell if I turn it round and show you what it says on the certificate, okay? So there's two possible answers to this, okay, as always, and you've got to work out which one it is. Number one is I am now an associate fellow at Sheffield Hallam University.
You're a strange fellow, I know that much.
Thank you. No, I'm an associate fellow, which means I'm basically a bit of an expert at what I do kind of thing. What I had to do I had to write, basically report the kind of stuff I've done with learning technology and teaching and learning digital technology and stuff like that, and that kind of gets assessed, and you become an associate fellow. It's about sort of like a talent sort of a talent recognition scheme that I took part in. So that's number one. Number two is it is a certificate, a qualification, certificate of achievement for seller management.
Is that right? So it's should we go for the first or the second one first? Let's do the first one first because that makes more sense. So. Is this in relation, because I believe you recently changed, well, I say recently, you changed roles at university probably about 9 months, a year ago, something like that?
Pretty much a year to this week, I think, actually.
All right, okay.
Or next week.
And so is this purely in relation to your new role, then? It's got nothing to do with what you did in the past?
No, I could write about, I could use things I've done in the past, because although I work directly in learning technology now, I've used software and programs and the ways of teaching and learning and stuff in classrooms in my other jobs as well, so I could write about my whole experience. Obviously, some of it's about being at the university so long to be able to do something like that as well. So,
did you, whilst as well as having the certificate, would you normally go to some kind of presentation ceremony for this? Appreciate obviously you can't at the moment given the social distance regulations and all that sort of stuff.
No, I don't think it's, I have graduated, as you may know, three times I've been a graduate in some shape or form, but it wasn't anything as prestigious as that.
Okay. Three degrees. Oh, kind of. You're like Diana Ross. Was she in 3 degrees? Or was that Supremes?
Don't know.
Sheila Ferguson, she's in 3 degrees. Anyway, so... I suppose one question is, without being rude or disrespectful, what's the actual point in having it?
Because it recognises you as a highly skilled staff member able to support academics who are very, very, very highly qualified, as you will know, university academics. So it's about having kind of giving our department that sort of authenticity that we've got staff trained to high levels and using certain technologies and so on, things like that.
Are other people in your department also sort of this standard?
A few people have, yeah, of course. You know, not everybody's been at the university as long as I have. Some people have been there longer, some people less. So it depends what to... You can't... I could have become a senior associate fellow, but that was a little bit more difficult to do considering there wasn't anyone else to in my team to self-certify me, if you know what I mean. So I couldn't do that on this occasion.
Well, surely self-certification is a process that's done by yourself as opposed to by someone else.
You know what I mean? Someone else who could, yeah, basically, because they've done the senior one, they could look at me, read what I'm, yeah, that kind of thing. Nobody could assess me.
Right. Well, I presume someone has got to be the first senior associate at some form. Mm-hmm. Did you find the work that was involved in this to be difficult?
Not too bad, no. No, it wasn't. I've done many things like MVQs before, which are quite mm-hmm. a lot of report writing and work, and yeah, and no, this wasn't that difficult.
Okay,
but I'm very proud of it.
Go on, congratulations if that's what you've got.
Yeah, it could just be a picture of anything.
Yeah, it could just be a thing. Who signed the award or the certificate?
D. Johnson,
Dr. Johnson, inventor of the dictionary back in those days.
Dan Jordan, actually. I was trying to read the scribble and I just presumed it was Johnson, but it does say underneath Dan Jordan.
Okay. And who's Dan Jordan?
I'm presuming he's the person who certified it.
Oh, right. Okay. So he's not sort of Chancellor of the University or Vice Chancellor or anything along those lines. Okay. So if we look at the second option, which is a certificate in cellar management, where did you get this and when?
I did an online course in cellar management.
By cellar, are we talking CELLAR, as in beer cellar?
Yes, not SELLER or AR. Yeah.
Not as in the art of selling.
Selling things, no. Oh, for sure, you've gone a little. Just. I'll wait for you to catch up. We've lost your signal very slightly.
All the rubbish in the room.
You've caught up, I think, now.
Sorry, yeah, I don't know if the signal just dropped out a little bit there.
Yeah.
Okay. So, yeah, what I was saying, I don't know if you heard that or not, but basically, we are talking about a beer cellar as opposed to a cellar that you might have in your property at home that's just filled with rubbish.
Yes. A beer cellar.
And you said it was an online course. When did you undertake that online course?
Just before the weekend.
All right, because it's nothing to do with the former job you had working at the Walter Arms pub in Chapel Town.
No.
Can you do cellar management?
As if they'd
have
put me on a qualification. Yeah. Sorry. Well, I, if this is true, I have done.
Okay. And why would you want to do that, bearing in mind you don't have a beer cellar?
I have a very keen interest in beer, and I have my own pub shed these days.
Which, to the best of my knowledge, doesn't have a cellar.
No, but there's more to, you know, just because you haven't got a cellar doesn't mean you can't look after beer, does it?
No, that's a very good point. And bear in mind you now have to do things like cleaning lines and all that sort of stuff, don't you, on you, from previous work. I would say, why did you, yeah, did you pass this with flying colours? Was there a test part of it?
Yeah, it was typically like one of those kind of things where you go through the modules, you do your learning, then there's some summary questions, and at the end you do an assessment.
Did it cost you anything to do it?
A little bit, yeah, not too much, just a very small fee.
Could he be any less vague about how much it cost?
It was £30.
£30.
Mm-hmm.
Is that including or excluding that?
Including, I think.
Okay. Do you think it was £30 well spent? Have you got skills that you think are transferable to elsewhere?
You could ask me about what I learned and what I know if you want to really test me.
Okay. How would you... If you've got a pint of beer and it's fobbing quite a lot, what would you do?
I would suggest that there is possibly air getting in to the beer. If it would depend on what the type of beer it was, but I would suggest it's there is air in it, yeah, in some way, or it could it could be off. There's other reasons it could be off, but generally it sounds like either the gas is not right, or there's too much getting in, or air's getting in, something like that.
Okay. How would you clean some lines?
Well,
in a pub cellar.
I can tell you what I do, but I think this is how the advice is as well. So you get two buckets. One you put in some sanitizer stuff or whatever you call it. You know what I mean?
I think it's generally called line cleaner, isn't it?
Line clean, sterilizing, sort of like granules or whatever. One bucket's full of plain water. You pull the plain water through first to clear the line and just get water running through it. And then about 8 pints worth-ish. And then you put your pipe into the line cleaning bucket. And then you pull that through and then you leave it in the pipe for probably at least 10 minutes. I like to personally try and go up to 20 minutes, half an hour if I can. And then after that, you pull it all through. And you can also, in the bucket if you want to, you can also drop your sparkler heads and anything else that's sort of attached and just get them clean as well. They can be sort of sat in there for a bit. But about 20 minutes, half an hour, then you pull the rest through and then you put the pipe back in the water and then pull another 8 pints of water through, checking the colour, making sure it's clear and there's no floaty bits of line cleaner in there or anything like that. And then, it's all good, yeah.
Okay. Yeah, to be fair, that's not too bad an explanation. I mean, all right, you didn't actually seem to understand that you use a product called line cleaner to clean the lines. But other than that,
I knew it was called line cleaner. I was trying to call it I was getting mixed up with sterilizer and sanitizer.
Right. Okay.
Because it's kind of like sterilizing stuff, isn't it? That's what it's doing.
Yeah. So, is it time for a decision? Do you think?
You could ask me a bit more about any of them if you want to.
Okay. Who have you told about getting this particular prize? Are you having some kind of celebration for it, for getting this award?
Well, obviously, I can't go to pubs yet, apart from my own, and inside pubs anyway. But no, I've not told anyone, because I like to put things on Instagram and Facebook and stuff, and I've done something great. And if it is the beer one, the cellar management one, then obviously I'd want to put that on my Ailing Audio pages, wouldn't I, and all that. But no, I haven't, because I thought this would make a good show and tell either way.
Good show and tell item. Yeah, which to be fair, sometimes I have to do that, you know.
Yeah.
Revoke things from social media for a while we kind of get on and do what we do. So is there any plans to kind of advance further from this current step that you're on? So do you want to use that as a building block to something bigger?
Maybe I might want to become a senior associate fellow one day, or it might help me to progress through the ranks within learning technology for myself as a bit of a, you know, for the learning technology one, and for it being the associate fellow one. It's just nice to have another qualification, particularly when I have a glowing business that does things like teachers using certain bits of software that you could use in teaching, learning, or in recruitment and things like that. So it's good to have an extra thing behind me. Might want to progress that one day. And then for the cellar management stuff, well, yeah, I've got, you know, I want to be able to say to my visitors who come round to my pub shed and try a pint that this is the perfect pint, and I have done a qualification to make sure that it is, because there was, in, you know, things about pulling pints and temperatures and things like that on there as well.
So you won't be able to say to people, I don't have a cellar, but let me tell you, if I did, it'd be very well managed. Is that what you want to say to people?
Yes.
Okay. Right, so it's time for a decision then, I suppose, isn't it? I think I've got sort of as much out of you that I'm going to get. And I'm going to say that... I'm going to say it's the first one. I think you've become some kind of research associate from the University of... Sheffield Hallam University.
Shall I reveal by spinning the certificate round and then you can read it?
Yeah, let's have a look. Cellar management. Oh, man.
Oh, no, you got it wrong.
Got it wrong.
So, it actually does say, now you might be, you know, taking the mickey out of me because I ain't got a cellar. It says a high quality, online training course designed to provide users with the proper knowledge needed to maintain high standards in the cellar. All right, I ain't got a cellar. And on the bar. So
on the bar.
I learned about cellar temperatures, which should be between... I mean, I learned it, not you, but...
Well, I presume you want it to be fairly... You don't want it to be below zero, but I presume you want it to be between 2 and 6 degrees centigrade, something like that, perhaps?
No, 11 and 15.
11 and 15.
Any colder than that, and you can get what they call beer freeze or something like that. Ale haze, freeze and haze, and it it can ruin the colour of the beer and all that kind of thing. To be fair, I do like it served a bit colder than the advice. If it's going to have to be between those temperatures, I definitely want it at the coldest temperature possible. But I do like it a little bit colder than that. But to make sure that the beer stays as good as it can for as long as it can, it needs to be down to between 11 and 15. So there you go. But I learned about pulling pints and the and how to pull the perfect pint and the types of glasses I should use for each type of drink. And there was stuff about hygiene and health and safety and accidents, which obviously, I'm not actually in a real pub, so that was all a bit irrelevant. But I am cellar management qualified now. So there you go.
Well, congratulations. Well done, Jimbo.
And I can hang it up in the... In fact, it was hung up, but I took it off to bring it and show you. So, there we go.
Well done. I'm delighted for you.
I was going to see how long you was going to walk for then, so I left the music on a bit longer to see if you'd carry on going. But
I'll try and get a few extra steps in. It's not a very big room that I'm podcasting from, so it's not very far to go.
What are you on today?
The Southwold Adnan's Best Bitter. On 17,100 thus far. I think, hopefully, after we finish podcasting, I might be able to kind of get out and do another sort of 1,000 or so steps and just sort of top that up to 18,000. Mm-hmm. But we'll see. It's actually quite surprising how many steps you do while you're just walking around the house, mm-hmm. is what I would say, in general.
Yeah,
I've been trying to do a few laps around the block.
Reciting Shakespeare as you go.
Yeah, carrying the sort of skull like Othello does. And all that sort of stuff. Yeah, reenacting various famous areas, bits from Shakespearean plays. Standing on the balcony, sort of shouting out for Romeo and all that sort of stuff. Walking along and sort of saying, is this a dagger I see before me, like in Macbeth?
Well, it's chapel town.
It could be, yeah. are we on to my bit?
Fisher. Get on with it.
I've got a little quiz.
Yeah.
And it's about the Ignobel Prize.
Oh, of course it's the Ignobel Prize. It would be the Ignobel Prize, wouldn't it? Because that's the easy quiz that you put together when you've had no time, when you're prioritising a little unknown sport people might want to know called cricket. Prioritising the cricket. I'm surprised you even get your helmet on.
Yeah. Do you know what the slightly bad news is at the moment? Is that
you haven't played either, have you?
The slightly bad news is that I'm sure I'd left sort of a note on my phone with all the text from the Ignobel Award, and it's not currently coming up, so I can't actually find it, which is a little bit annoying.
Oh, here we go. So the dog ate it, did it?
The cat
accessed your iPhone, did it?
Yeah, I've got nothing, man. I've got absolutely. It's not here. It's on my computer. I'm gonna have to log on to my computer.
Do you want me to jump in?
No, should we just do the news bit first and then we can do the quizzes perhaps?
I'll tell you what, let me do mine because we'll have a quiz and we'll come back to news. Mine's pretty quick anyway.
Why don't we talk about a couple of news items and I can jump on and do the quiz stuff.
Fair enough. So let's go with news then. Matt Hancock, he had his jab. Is that one you want to talk about first?
Yeah,
Tourism Matt Hancock, we can talk Keir Starmer.
We can talk about them both, really, can't we?
Yeah.
Slag them both off, it's not a problem. So Matt Hancock had his COVID jab. Apparently, it's just a small, annoying little prick. And apparently, he's also had his COVID jab.
Oh, yeah, of course, yeah.
He had Professor Van Tam doing it, if you saw that.
Yeah, how come you get? Is this where we're getting to now? That you have sort of different celebrities doing your
celebrity doctors.
Yeah.
Yeah, sounds like it. It seems quite cool, Van Tam, doesn't it? I mean, probably a bit cooler than Chris Whitty. I think we mentioned on the podcast before that Chris Whitty might end up sort of appearing on Strictly Come Dancing and various other bits and bobs. Van Tam does seem.
I was thinking it's going to work on things like Love Island, you know, when they, you know, you're a big Love Island fan, when they start. I can't do the impression of the bloke, but, you know, something like, Nicole hasn't had a vaccine. She's unable to go to the snuggle pod or whatever they call it.
To the hideaway.
Yeah. Is that what they're going
to
do?
I don't know how it's going to work. I'm assuming everyone must be tested beforehand to make sure they don't come in contact. But I think it is meant to be abroad. They said it's definitely coming back on, but we'll have to take a load more contestants out. I presume it will be quite
more?
Difficult in terms
There's going
of...
to be more of them?
Yeah, I presume they're going to have people waiting in the wings ready in case they have to... certain people can't make it or whatever. So that's that in terms of Love Island. Also, as I say, we did say we would talk about other people as well, and the Labour Party is... they didn't perform very well in the elections, did they?
No.
If you saw?
No.
It was the elections last Thursday for local councils, London mayor elections. There was a by-election in Hartlepool as well.
The difficult thing is, like, the sad thing is that under Jeremy Corbyn's leadership, even though there was still a lot of falling outs and so on under that, I think people kind of did understand or were got a lot more about what Labour stood for then. Even if some of the party didn't stand for it, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Like there was, it might have been, but there was a clear message from the top, wasn't there, in terms of the leadership where they felt about certain things, and I feel like I understood it, but obviously there was a lot of infighting within the party. But now they've gone to this thing now where nobody really knows what's going on with it, and so I think you know we had a lot of. People are saying this now. People were saying that before. Well, I think you know, we did have something we could have clung on to a little bit more for those that are more to the left of things, maybe central left than what we, you know, than what the sort of current government is, and so on. Anyway,
yeah, no, so that's a reasonable analysis, actually, to be fair. So well done. So yeah, I think there was sort of a fairly clear message from Jeremy Corbyn, albeit perhaps not that many people agreed with it. But there we go. Keir Starmer seems to be, well, you can tell he's a solicitor, really, can't you? I mean, when you watch him at Prime Minister's Questions, he's quite sort of carefully dissects Boris Johnson's arguments and sort of, you can tell he's obviously trying to effectively win a court case against him, which is a thought, to be fair, would be very good practice for Boris Johnson, because he'll probably be in court fairly soon anyway. So,
they've announced an independent review into how the coronavirus pandemic's been handled. I wonder if it's going to be like that independent review into racism and various things like that as well, and how that one turned out.
Oh yeah, it was great news actually, that, because there isn't a problem with racism.
There's been no problem with how there's been no problem with how the coronavirus pandemic's been handled either. Even though we've had 130,000 deaths over similar sized island nations that have had a lot less, but it's okay because we've got the vaccine sorted now.
Yeah, and to be fair, getting the vaccine sorted is probably the best news I've heard for the country since it turned out that we've solved racism. So, well done. All very good news.
But Keir Starmer might have done better if he'd not spent all his time in pubs. Sorry, getting kicked out of pubs.
Good point. Yeah, actually, what was he doing in the pub in the first place? Because surely you're only allowed to have table service outside.
Yeah, true.
Unless you're going to the toilet.
Get him out of my pub with that bloke was shouting. What was going on there? Yeah. Everyone missed that bit, didn't they, really? Yeah. We didn't talk about it last time, but everyone seemed, maybe he was just going to the toilet, because you can go into the toilet inside.
Yeah.
So.
I don't know. Interesting. Anyway, the good news is I've got my quiz up.
All right, okay. Should we get on with that then?
Quite what happened to the first version of it, I really don't know, because I'm sure I saved it to my phone. But never mind. So anyway, it's the Ignobel Award 2013 we're on to. I mean, we've still got another about 20-odd years of this to go, which will keep us entertained on the podcast for a while. So, what won the award for archaeology? Was it for someone who parboiled a dead shrew and then swallowed the shrew without chewing? He then carefully examined everything excreted in subsequent days. Or is it for liquidising some fossils and drinking them? They were then compared to drinking liquidised stones. and that is stones as in rocks and not the bitter that used to be brewed in Sheffield.
Okay, so he ate a shrew and then... analysed
and
his poo.
And then sort of, yeah, analysed his own poo and not the shrew's poo.
Okay.
Is the first one, or the second one, is liquidated, or liquidised rather, some fossils, and drank them.
And compared them to what they tasted like compared to stones.
Yeah, I think it's more sort of how it goes through your body, and sort of what the effect is on you. A fossil compared to just a rock.
Okay.
Wouldn't you be a bit annoyed, though, if you ran sort of a museum, and... someone got the fossils and just sort of stuck them in a blender, blended them up and just drank them, and it would be very, very frustrating and disappointing.
Yeah. Well, apparently it's really good for your, you know, when you're going to be going, like, running and exercising and, you know, doing your walking and stuff like that. It's a fossil fuel, isn't it? So, there you go. Anyway, let's go with the first one, I think. So I think the first one's quite an odd one to have made up.
Okay.
So if you've made that up, there's something wrong with you.
Well, that's debatable anyway. You'd be right, well done.
Well, we know there's something wrong with you, but anyway.
Yeah. So next up, for the award for biology / astronomy, was it for discovering that foxes can travel to locations over 20 miles away, navigating just by the moon? Or for discovering that dung beetles... can navigate their way home by looking at the Milky Way.
My friends, we went. They could be having me on with this, but we went out to Kelham Island a week on Saturday. So we, you know, for first time going out since about October or whatever. you know, friends.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm aware. I'm aware of what the concept of having friends is like. I know you never invite me on these things.
Oh, you're joking.
I'm aware that you and some other people went on it, yeah.
Okay. So anyway, they said afterwards the next day that I was saying that the moon wasn't real and it was on string. They were saying that that's what I was talking about. Now, I can't remember if I did or didn't say that, whether they're having me on or not, but apparently I said that the moon isn't real. It's on a bit of string or something.
What you're basically saying is you had a lot to drink.
Yeah. But anyway... so it's either that foxes can navigate, they can travel sort of 20 miles just by sort of following the moon. Or number two was what again, sorry? Option two.
That dung beetles can navigate their way home by looking at the Milky Way and sort of the stars and all that sort of stuff.
So they, were they investigating that or did they actually discover this?
I don't know. I've not... On whichever one it is, I haven't looked into it in that amount of depth, really.
I'm going to go foxes, I think.
Foxes can navigate by the moon? You'd be incorrect. I do know that my dad once managed to navigate by the moon when we were on holiday in Portugal. He went to go and buy something. He had to try and work out how to get back, so he sort of needed to look at where the moon was and which way he'd gone.
You went on holiday to the moon?
Not to them, but now just to Portugal.
Oh, right, okay. Cheap, fair enough.
Cheaper, easier to get to as well.
Yeah. Is it on the which? What list is it on the moon? Is it on the green list?
I don't know. Actually, I'm assuming it probably is. Yeah. Yeah. What do you have to do if you're coming back to space, coming back from space? Do you have to self isolate or? Actually, talking about that, I did see that Coldplay. I mean, I'm quite a Coldplay fan, as you know, and Chris Martin from Coldplay. I think he's a very good musician. I really like his music. I like his singing. I like his piano playing, particularly on some of the earlier tracks. Very good. I think he's quite a good frontman. But he does an half sort of... I find him in interviews to be a bit kind of...
a twat.
Yeah. Yeah, basically, for want of a better word. I don't particularly like to say it to someone who I am such a fan of their actual music and songwriting and all that sort of stuff. But he was saying that the lockdown had...
made him reassess his ego or something like that.
Something like that, yeah. And then I'm assuming you read the news article about it. It led to him, pretty much, yeah, bang on, reassessing his ego. Did you see what the next paragraph said?
No.
It said that Coldplay's new song had been debuted by playing it to someone who was in space. You think, how well did you reassess your ego there, actually? I mean, because you know, the debut of your song gets sent out, I think it was a French astronaut that was on the International Space Station. They sent it to him for, as the first public showing of the song.
Yeah. Yes, this is brilliant. Yeah, the music's great. The mute, the keys, the sound, the rhythm, everything. Yeah, lead singer's a bit of a twat though.
Yeah, but there we
all
go.
Of that in anyway. French.
So we've digressed a little bit. Yeah. But anyway, on to the Ignobel Award for Chemistry, which is who won the award for chemistry?
I got the wrong answer there, didn't I?
Yeah. You did, yes.
Yeah. Okay, I think I did mark myself wrong. Yeah, it's fine.
Yeah. So, the wrong answer. The answer for chemistry, what did the person do? Was it for discovering that a biochemical process by which onions make people cry is even more complicated than scientists first thought? Or is it for working out if you need more or less heat to effectively cook different types of pasta depending on what the shape of the pasta is?
Hmm. Right. So
is it that the process by which onions make people cry is a bit more complicated?
Yeah, let's start with that one. I think the onion one is there's definitely something in that, because I used to cut onions, and when I had my glasses on, when I wore glasses, it used to really affect me, and I used to get really upset, and you know, as you do when your eyes start streaming when you're cutting onions. But when I wore my contact lenses,
sorry, you didn't get upset though, did you? I mean, no, tears might come out of your eyes, but you weren't sort of actually upset for cutting the onions. I mean, onions are there.
It's only when I had Coldplay on. It's only when I had Coldplay on in the background.
Yeah.
But anyway, no. But when I had my contact lenses in, it wouldn't affect me. Now I've had my laser eye surgery. I haven't had any effects from onions at all since. Which is really strange, and I think there is a lot. There's a deeper thing, and they say if you hum and stuff like that, that you don't get affected either. So that's one.
When you had your laser eye surgery, did the person who was doing it just kind of like just dab his finger in a bit of onion, just wipe it across your eye, just to kind of bit like being vaccinated against the onions, like you have for COVID jab, just sort of give a little bit of it to you to sort of inoculate.
And the what happened? Do you think the second one? Just remind me of that again.
Second one is for working out whether more or less heat was needed to effectively cook different types of pasta, depending on what shape it is.
I'm just trying to get my head around this. So they've got like things like you've got your different pasta shapes, haven't you? So you've got your straight spaghetti, sort of lasagna, like strip sort of things. Sheets.
Yeah, you've got your ravioli.
Yeah. Hold on. The penny's dropped. I know what you're on about now. Yeah, I think. I think it's the onion one, definitely.
Okay, the onions. You'd be correct. Hold on.
I'm trying to stick up for some of this research, even though it's been awarded for being useless research.
Yeah. So I believe the tip for cutting onions to make sure you don't start crying is to cut it underwater. Have you heard that? That you submerge the onion in water and then cut it.
Because I thought you meant I had to get like a diving tank.
No, so you can put your hands in the knife underwater right, okay. That submerging your entire body.
Yeah.
All you do is you have to get in a car that then goes in the bath. And then fine. So yeah, you can do that. Or, I mean, one thing that I remember about onions, I'm not a massive onion fan. But I do remember watching an episode of Four in a Bed, is it called? You know, the Channel 4... program where it takes four people and they go to different people's guest houses.
Sounds like
four couples.
It sounded more like something on Channel 5, to be honest, but yeah, I'll go with it.
Yeah, if you go to... Yeah, have you ever watched it before on Channel 4?
Yeah, I think... Is it a bit like it's a bit like Come Down With Me, but trying people's guest houses out and stuff like that, isn't it? Yeah.
Pretty much, yeah. And at the end of it, you scored the guest house and what have you. And I remember watching one episode a few years ago, and someone's comment was... the room smelt like it had just been painted, which I presume is because the room had recently been painted, you know, trying to keep it nice, keep it well decorated, looked after, and maybe they let people into the room a little bit earlier than they should have done. Perhaps, might be the case that they're mindful that they're about to appear on television, they've got guests staying there, all that sort of stuff. But she said, what you can do to take the smell away is chop an onion in half and leave that out to help take away the smell of paint. So which I thought, it's just gonna does it take away the smell of paint, or does it just make your room stink of onions? It's a bit like saying, I'll tell you what, why don't you just get a bloke in and get him to fart for ages inside the room, and then it won't smell of paint, will it?
Yeah, that's, yeah. Apparently, because it's so, I suppose they're saying that the onion's going to soak up any scent or whatever. I don't know. Acts like some sort of dehumidifier, maybe, or I don't know. Anyway,
I genuinely don't know. But yeah, that was the comment that came back. Mm. Next up, award for medicine. What happened to this? Was it for assessing the effect of listening to opera on mice who have had heart transplants, or is it for assessing the effect of a long car journey on dogs and seeing the difference made by the tempo of music being played whilst in the car?
I don't think that there will be that many mice who have had heart transplants. I mean, well,
that's what you
think. Not that they would have kept alive and so on, either. Not that many. I know they've got to practice on something, but it's odd to practice on something so very small.
I mean, you've recently undertaken a long car journey to Whitby and back. Was a dog there?
That I had no dog.
So you just rolled your eyes then. So I'm assuming
my mum's got dogs. But I can imagine that the a dog is more chill if it can hear nicer music or whatever, softer music.
Listen to Coldplay, think. Oh, tell you no. what, that's fantastic. But the lead singer, what a twat.
So let's go with the dog one, shall we?
Dog one. Unfortunately, you'll be wrong. Yeah, apparently they enjoyed the effect, or the assessed listening to opera music on mice, particularly mice that have heart transplants. I don't know how many mice have had heart transplants. That said, how many mice have you seen that haven't had heart transplants that you know for a fact haven't had them? Could be the case that they've all had them.
Yeah.
Suspect not many have, though, to be fair, but there we go.
Well, apparently it's supposed to be a secret, isn't it? Because obviously they're not supposed to test on animals and stuff like that, but a few of the mice squeaked and obviously revealed all, so, yeah.
Fair enough. Next up, at peace, Alexander Lushenko, president of Belarus. What did he do to win the prize? Was it for making it illegal to take part in any form of protest, thus banning chanting, singing, and stamping your feet? Or did he make it illegal to applaud in public?
I don't know why you'd want it to be illegal to applaud, because that's generally seen as a good thing. Did you say that, is it the same person who's in charge now?
I think so. I think he's one of the very few people to have won two Ignobel Awards.
Is he won one recently, hasn't he?
I think he won recently alongside Boris Johnson, yeah. Donald Trump, Jan Bolsonaro.
For not doing enough, about coronavirus.
Basically, yeah.
Yeah. Okay, let's go with the first one then. I think he banned protesting or whatever.
Protests?
Yeah.
You'll be incorrect. He banned applauding in public.
That seems odd.
Yeah. There was also a commendation. Is that right? There was a highly recommended to the Belarus State Police because they managed to arrest a one-armed man for applauding in public. So there we go. It's not quite a certificate in cellar management, but never mind.
Yeah, so they arrested a one-armed man for clapping.
Yeah. I'm assuming he was making noise against his leg or whatever, but yeah, they did apparently arrest a one-armed man for clapping. I don't even know how they handcuffed him, to be honest. But
okay.
There you go. So, next up, probability. What would the word for probability? Is it, first, that the longer the cow has been lying down, the more likely the cow will stand up soon? And, once a cow stands up, you cannot easily predict how soon that cow will lie down again. Or is it for proving that if a cat is inside and the door to go outside is open, it is more likely that the cat will want to stay inside. But if the door is closed, it is more likely that the cat won't want to go outside.
The second one is definitely, you don't need to be a researcher to know that one. That is definitely true. But what is this research about is the question. Now, the cow one, have you heard before that, because there's a thing about cows laying down meaning it's going to rain, doesn't it? And I heard
possibly. Yeah.
Yeah, I heard the thing about that was because they like dry. They like eating dry grass rather than wet grass, so they lay down and keep it dry underneath them.
Yeah.
I don't know if that's true or not, but the cow one then about whether it's, you know, of course if it's been laying down for a long time, of course it's going to stand up soon, which is what makes it an Ignobel award, I suppose, of pointless sort of thing, bit of research. The second one, I don't think you need to. I think that is just an ignorant cat thing, to be honest with you. So let's go with maybe the second one's your research. So let's go with the first one.
What, based on my own cat?
Yeah.
You'd be correct. Well done. Yeah, and I think it is right. I mean, you've got a cat as well. Basically, open the door, not bother about going out, shut the door, wants to go out.
Of course, yeah.
And then similarly, when it comes to coming back in, you leave the door open for it to walk into, shut it because it's starting to get cold, and then she'll disappear at the door and say, I want to come back in.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Don't know.
They meow to be let out. You let them out, and then the back door wanting to come back in. So they wanted to go out to walk round the house to the back door to come back in. So either they're too lazy or stupid to walk through the house to the back door because they want to stand near the back door. So they go out the front and then go around the back so they can get in at the back and then the way they want it to be. They're just ignorant, aren't they?
I think they're doing part of a walking challenge for work. So trying to get as many steps in as possible to go all the way around the
Maybe
house.
Some of these cats should have reassessed their ego during the lockdown period.
Yeah. That would be a good idea. Maybe just jumping back to my thought is that maybe I could strap my mobile phone to my cat and see how far she gets during the day and see what steps she can do for me.
Yeah, whatever you do, don't put Coldplay on there.
Yeah, that'd be far too much for her. next up, anyway, physics. What won the award for physics? Is it for discovering the colour red is the most effective when camouflaging, or for discovering that some people will be physically capable of running across the surface of a pond? But only if those people in the pond were on the moon. Although if they were, they'd probably be too busy listening to the new Coldplay track.
Okay. Right. Well, red doesn't strike me as a very camouflage colour. There's not.
Sorry, I can't quite see you saying that. all I can see is it's sat in your red shirt and on your red chair as well.
Okay, right. Right now I might be a bit camouflaged, but generally, it's quite a standout colour, isn't it? You know what I mean? They do say there's a bit of research saying that red cars are the ones that have the most crashes, apparently.
So no one can see them. Because they're camouflaging all the stuff.
Exactly. Maybe there's something in that. Right, in that case, I'm going to go for that one.
Okay. You'd be wrong. Next up, psychology. What won the
award? You just did some psychology on me there.
If you listen to what I'm telling you, then, you know, I can't even legislate for that sort of nonsense with what I'm saying. But anyway, award for psychology. So what won the award for psychology? Was it for confirming that people who think they are drunk also think they are attractive and also think that the moon is on a piece of string? or is it for demonstrating that a basketball player was more likely to successfully throw a three throw if they said the words "I am Superman" 10 times before taking the throw? Which I presume is sort of positive reinforcement and all this sort of stuff. And, you know, if you tell yourself you're going to succeed, then you'll succeed, or something along those lines.
Yeah. So I reckon it is the basketball one for this one.
Okay.
Yeah.
You're wrong again. No. It's the.
No, I'm right, Fisher. Yeah. I'm right. Am I right?
Yeah, you're right.
Yes,
yeah.
Thank you.
I won't be tricked into that. You are unfortunately wrong. It is the case that drunk people also think they are attractive, or more often than not. I made the one up about the Superman basketball. Although I suspect there probably is something in that, that if you tell yourself you're good and have that positive thought process, then you're more likely to succeed and do well.
So what did you say? I got distracted by my beautiful reflection in this glass.
Indeed. Although it is a bit that glass is quite oddly shaped, so it might sort of take the imperfections of your face back in and make it look alright. Anyway, next up, public health. What won the award for public health? Is it for the research paper named The Effect of Frostbite on Men's Toes in Nordland, which is the north part of Norway, compared to the effect of frostbite on men's toes in Lapland, which is the north part of Finland? It concluded that actually the effect of frostbite was fairly similar in both locations. Or is it for the medical technique described in their report as surgical management of an epidemic on penile amputations in Siam?
So, the removal of the penis in where?
Siam. So, I think it's Thailand, isn't it? Far East.
Why?
I don't know.
Is it some sort of tradition or is it a punishment?
It might not necessarily be in humans, to be fair.
Oh, fair enough. Okay.
Although, to be fair, why would you remove an animal's penis? It doesn't really make a huge amount of sense either.
Yeah. Okay. I reckon it might be the second one. The weird one. Let's go with the weird one. Maybe they're both weird, but yeah.
Yeah, you'd be right, well done. And this is genuinely true what I'm about to say. Apparently, the techniques in the report are all recommended, except in cases where the amputated penis has been partially eaten by a duck. That's what it says. Okay. Nothing more to add other than that's what it says on that matter. And finally, last one, safety engineering. What won the award for safety engineering? Is it for inventing a system to trap airplane hijackers? The system drops a hijacker through some trapdoors, seals him in a package, and then drops him through the aeroplane's flaps out of the aeroplane. He's parachuted to Earth, where police, who have been alerted by radio, can await his arrival.
Okay.
Let's be honest, I'm sure it's fairly straightforward. I've got a hijacker, I'm just dropping him out of the aeroplane. I'll land him somewhere in England. Can you pick him up, please?
Yeah.
Or for inventing a method of checking whether all meat has been sufficiently cooked to ensure that it does not possess any harmful bacteria. Whilst the tests were actually quite highly accurate, unfortunately, it did take about 4 hours to give the results, and it was generally accepted that putting the thermometer in the meat was just as effective.
I was going to say, there's already something to do that sort of thing, isn't there?
Well, it tests the temperature, doesn't necessarily test for bacteria.
Okay. Let's.
Although most bacteria won't live at a certain temperature.
Exactly. So. Let's go with the second one, then.
Okay. You would be incorrect.
So you're saying this person thought that you could invent something that would trap a hijacker, drop them out of the plane, and then hopefully land them without killing them somewhere that the police could pick them up?
Yeah, it gets parachuted back to Earth, and the police, who've been alerted by radio, can await. It says his arrival, so it's a bit...
Yeah.
Definitely assuming it's going to be a bloke doing it, which is probably fair enough. it's a bit of an unusual one. As I say, I don't know how accurately you can drop someone out of an aeroplane with a parachute and just assume that they will land in a certain spot. It'd
be worse if it was like voice activated as well, and you know, you were there, you say you're going on a stag do with your friends or whatever, and you're sat there and you're waiting for your friend who's, you know, stuck in the airport like they do, you know. Or he goes off to the toilet, you know, and you've not seen him for a while, and you know, because sometimes you get put separately on the plane, don't you, from your friend. You know, because you can't always get seats together, can you? So imagine they, you know, midway through the flight, they walk up the plane to come and just, you know, like you, say hello, how's your flight going and all that. Your friend's walking up, you look up, take your eye mask off. Hi, Jack. Doors open, down it goes. That'd be a nightmare.
Oh, yeah. I think by the sound of it, they've got to sort of like break in through one door and they can't get into a sealed chamber before the next door and then they can get dropped through the floor. But yeah, it doesn't really make a great deal of sense, to be fair. But that's what won the award. And, you know, good on the person who's done it. In a fantastic inventor. I'd like to think that's never actually been implemented in any aircraft, but you never quite know.
Was that the last one?
That was the last one, so well done.
Enjoyed that. Cheers, Fisher. So before we come back on, we've kind of covered everything I think we wanted to in the news. So before we come back onto that... I'm going to play a little advert. Fisher, if you want to get your steps in.
I'll go and do a bit of walking then.
Yeah. Have you heard of cryptocurrency? Bitcoin, Dogecoin and Litecoin to name a few. Do you wish you'd got there sooner before the boom? Well, now's your chance to make up for it. Introducing Shitcoin. Shitcoin is a brand new unregulated cryptocurrency aimed at the modern working man or woman, non-binary person or ostrich. Yes, we're calling out you millennials to jump on board Shitcoin. How does it work, you might ask? Well, at Shitcoin, we want to do things differently. Shitcoin can be used to only buy things that no one else wants or needs, like toothbrush maracas, high-yield flippers, or the self-watering watering can. It's a watering can that when you tip the water out to spout, it just fills its end back up again. Anyway, buy a bunch of these shit coins and you'll be a shitcoin millionaire. You'll be shitting coins as no one else wants them. You can use them to invest in other projects and products that don't take off, like Keir Starmer's hopes of winning the next election, or grow your own Boris haircut set. Shitcoin. Where the money's worth shit. Got your steps in there, Fisher?
Yeah, I think so. Yeah, all right.
You missed me trying to do a Yorkshire accent, even though I've already got a Yorkshire accent.
I'll have to listen back to that later on this evening.
Anyway, so I've got a quiz, and I think I came across this because I decided to do this as I saw a funny headline that really I should have put in the headline of the week thing, but you know, there's the I don't know if you're into boxing, I'm not particularly into it, but I did see a funny headline about, you know, that kind of made me laugh, and it was Billy Joe Saunders reveals huge row over size of ring against Canelo, which I thought was quite funny. And then I started having a look, is there anything you can, you know, sporting headlines or anything like that that I could do a bit of a quiz about, and I landed on a couple of pages about headlines from the Sunday Sports. A paper that I don't read, I am very unlikely to read in future, but they have had some quite amazing headlines that are pretty bonkers, and how made up they are, I don't know, but I thought we could do a quiz based on it.
I mean, I don't think you actually read the Daily Sport or Sunday Sport, do you? I think most people buy it to look at the pictures, really, I think is a general gist of that, am I right?
Yeah, I imagine so. But you're ready for some of these headlines. There's some multiple choice and there's some things you've got to do a bit of a guessing sort of game. Okay. I put on it, listen to the headline and tell me if it's real or fake, but I just decided, you know what, they're all real. So they are all real headlines. Forget that bit. But you've got a different task associated with each one. So number one, the headline from the Sport on Sunday Sport, whatever it is. Sorry for shitting outside your house, .. And we're looking for a celebrity's name, okay? Now, obviously, that's not much to go on.
He just invested in shitcoin, hasn't he?
But I can give... Do you want a two-word thing for you to guess this celebrity? So, sorry for shitting outside your house. Your two words is...
Sorry, hang on. Is it this? I'm assuming it's someone who's... shit outside the celebrity's house, not a celebrity who shit outside someone else's house, yeah?
Yes.
So the celebrity is an unwilling victim of this crime.
This random person is a builder who is apologising for shitting outside this particular celebrity's house, but it was a headline on the paper. Sorry for shitting outside your house, .. And your two-word clue is Big Brother.
I'm assuming probably Davina McCall, maybe, or maybe...
Well done. So Builder admitted after getting off a train in the village of Wadhurst, he was really desperate for the toilet, so decided to go in a spot near the train station, which happens to back onto where Davina McCall's house was. I don't think it was the Big Brother house, I think it was her actual house. It appears that many desperate passengers in the past have used this spot. So it's not just a one-off thing, but this one builder saw an article about it and decided to, when he realised he didn't poo outside of Davina McCall's house, he decided to ring the paper and tell them.
No, he would have got away with it. It was just sort of squatting down, just having a dump, and then all of a sudden this voice said, "This is Big Brother." And that's been watched, so...
Yeah, anyway. Next then. Number two. Lad shat in teacher's kettle to dodge what? A, lesson, B, parents' evening, or C, exams?
I don't quite understand what the point is. Is it hoping that he's going to get expelled, so therefore doesn't have to do his exams or doesn't have to do something? Or
presuming so, yeah.
So I mean, well, it's quite strange that we talked about pissing the kettle earlier on, didn't we?
Yeah, there you go.
So just run through the options again, then.
So lad chatting teacher's kettle to dodge A, lesson, B, parents' evening, or C, exams.
I think maybe parents' evening.
The thing is, if it's parents' evening, it's just going to make parents' evening worse, isn't it? You know,
this lad
doesn't want to do. He doesn't seem to want to do his exams, or he doesn't want to seem to do his lessons. He also did a shit in my kettle, so I don't think it's going to be that one, is it? No, it's exams. So he obviously wanted to get out of exams, so tried to get himself expelled. Anyway, mm-hmm. Number three. This headline was: "It's a forking miracle." Okay, which is the headline itself isn't anything special. But the news story itself is that a face of a late comedian appears in a gardener's fork tool handle. Okay, but who was the comedian? So it's a forking miracle was the headline. I don't know if you want to guess based on that or if you want me to give you some options.
I wonder if it might be one of the two Ronnies. With it being fork, so I'd maybe say Ronnie Barker. Yeah.
No.
All right, Ronnie Corbett, sorry.
So, yeah, then you kind of got part of it right. So I was going to say Ken Dodd, so you eliminated Ken Dodd without me even having given you the chance to hear his name. But anyway, number four, banned in every pub in Hull for A, shitting in the urinals, or B, slut-dropping the slot machines.
So slut-dropping, is it a slut-dropping where you sort of basically take all the coins out of the slot machines?
No.
I think.
It's where you, a dance move. Where you kind of where the lady sort of like
sorry, you're gonna have to give us a visual representation of how this works. Sorry,
it's like where she sort of drops down like and squats down in front of a man, sort of thing.
Right, okay. I think I know the dance move that you're referring to, that you've so fantastically demonstrated for any audio listeners listening to this. So I thought it might have been where you kind of go in and just take loads of money out of the jackpot machines, out of the bandits. I don't think that someone would have shit in every... I said the shit quite a lot on this episode. I don't think you would have done that on every single urinal in all the pubs in Hull. But I think you might have slut drops in front of them, so I'm going to say the second one.
Shitting in the urinals. I was once accused of that, by the way. Which I definitely didn't do. And it's, I'd been to a Danny Bembo, a good friend of ours, who was went off travelling to Thailand and to work in Thailand and, you know, having a good time and so on. Then he went to New Zealand and he was away for quite a long time. But on the first, when he was leaving for the very first time, his big bye-bye, I'm leaving sort of thing.
His big bye-bye, you shat in a urinal as a goodbye.
No, we had some, what do you call it, sangria on the tables, and I ended up drinking quite a lot of it, and it's really dark, reddish sort of in colour, and obviously when it goes into your stomach, and drank way too much of it, and I was sick in a urinal, but because of the colour, I definitely didn't do, I definitely didn't poo in a urinal, and I've had to deny that many times before, although I think they just do it to wind me up now, but anyway, you know, as tell me that the moon, I said that the moon was strung up by string, but it wasn't. Anyway, so let's. It was the first one, but I don't think she'd done it in every urinal in Hull. I think she did it in one or two, and then it was a she. Have she gone in there in the first place?
Well, women don't use urinals, sure.
She does.
Perhaps she's fundamentally not understand what the urinals are for because she's not very familiar with them.
Exactly, all needed was just explaining, you know. And we need to tell her what a urinal cake is as well, because that could go horribly wrong too if she's not careful. Ooh, cake. Anyway, number four. No, it was number four. This is number five. Boris Johnson, blank. So you've got to fill in the blank. Boris Johnson, blank, gobbled my cock. So is it A, girlfriend, B, pig, or C, dog?
I was going to say lookalike, but girlfriend. Well, I mean, to be honest, I mean, I don't know if I've had that many girlfriends. It's a bit difficult to nail one down. Surely.
Pig. I'm not sure if this is if this is why he owes £535 to the county court, but
I think by cock it might mean hen, cockerel, chicken kind of thing. So I think it's probably an animal. And is it a pig or is it a dog? Farmyard, I'm going to say pig.
It was the pig, well done. Yes, and it was the cock was talking. It was basically a farmer, apparently watched in horror as pig with hair resembling Boris Johnson ate his prize cockerel. But he's fine because the pig got its comeuppance because David Cameron turned up a little bit later on. Number six. Chuckle Brother Double is a Morrison's checkout lady or B, a stag night stripper.
Oh man.
We're talking about Barry as well.
Well, it doesn't really matter, does it? I mean, to be fair, I mean, if your lady looks like the Chuckle Brother, then you don't say, "Wait, so I look like a slightly more attractive than one of them." I mean, yeah, I mean, sure, yeah, surely, yeah, for a woman, I look like a Chuckle Brother. It's just not good in general. I think Stack Night Stripper.
Well done. Apparently charges £200 for a sex act named To Me To You.
Yeah. Oh,
absolutely. That's what it says in the article. I haven't made that one up. Right. Let's stop being silly now. Number 7. Jeremy Corbyn's sex dwarf. A, eaten by otters.
By an otter?
Otters. Or B, runs for local elections.
How small must the dwarf be if he gets eaten by some otters? Are you sure he's not bitten by one as opposed to eaten?
No, eaten runs by otters.
Or runs for local elections. I mean, anyone can. Oh, actually, sorry, I've got something to talk about in relation to elections. I think he might have run for local elections just as a bit of a novelty candidate. I mean, haven't they got Lord Binhead in London or wherever he's called?
He used to be Lord Buckethead.
Lord Buckethead.
Okay. Jeremy Corbyn's sex dwarf eaten by otters. So, I mean, this is you know, it's not a nice story for the Jeremy Corbyn bloke. Dwarf, because he died in a canoe incident. Apparently, he was a keen canoer. He was also apparently a keen dogger, the report decided to mention as well. He was that's why he was called Sex Dwarf, because he was known for getting about a bit. He died in a canoe incident and was found with otter nibbles on him.
Oh, okay.
So
he only ate a small part of him.
Nibbled on him.
Actually, even worse.
Yeah.
So what I was going to talk about with elections is the candidate for police and crime commissioner in Swindon, if you saw this.
All right.
Have you seen this? He's expected to win, a Tory candidate. Is it Swindon? It's sort of in that sort of area, Wiltshire or what have you. And unfortunately, he then realised that he had a conviction about 30 years ago for drink driving, so therefore is ineligible to stand for election. So they're going to have to count the votes because people voted. He's going to be withdrawn from the process, but he's still going to count them because people voted in it, so you've got to follow the correct process. He's not going to get in, because, as I say, he's going to have to withdraw because it now turns out he's ineligible, even though he claimed that he'd actually notified the Tory party and they still selected him anyway.
Of course they did.
And they're going to have to rerun the election. It's going to cost, they reckon, about £1.7 million to rerun it.
Oh, right, okay. Well, I'm sure they can find that money, can't they? They'll just ask a friend or something like that.
What a complete and utter waste of public money.
Again.
Although I would actually possibly say, in the man's defence, I wouldn't particularly be too bothered if a candidate running for police and crime commissioner, which I know very little about what the police and crime commissioner actually does, I don't really see that they actually need them. I don't really understand what the role is of police and crime commissioner. I wouldn't really care less whether the person who's currently standing for it has got a drink drive commission from 30 years ago or not.
They commission crime, don't they? Just, we'll commission that one and that one. Contracts going to to Tory friend. Oh, yeah, we'll commission that. Yeah. That's fine.
It's crime, definitely commit that. Yeah.
That's
what we'll do. So yes, there we go. But anyway, let's move on back to the Sunday sports headlines.
Okay, I've bonked 500 women. And the headline that I'm going to read, I've bonked 500 women pretending to be A, Boris Johnson, B, Jeremy Clarkson, or C, James May.
Hmm. Well, it was the person who said that, it was actually Boris Johnson, wasn't it, actually? And he said he bonked 500 women pretending to be Boris Johnson, I think. Now, I think I vaguely remember this as being Clarkson. Now, I mean, to be fair, obviously Boris Johnson's got a bit of a reputation. Clarkson and May probably haven't and probably aren't that particularly attractive either. But I wonder whether or not pretending to be Jeremy Clarkson might be able to get you some success with the ladies, who's probably better known than James May. So I'm going to say Clarkson.
Is actually James May.
James May.
There you go. Two more. Number nine. This headline involves an excuse being made by someone who was accused of being a pervert in a supermarket. Okay, just to give you a bit of background. Okay. So, yeah. Number nine. I wasn't flashing my willy. I was A, reorganising my balls, or B, shoplifting sausages.
I did hear that there was once a postman who was accused of exposing himself when he was on his rounds, kind of thing. And his response was, "She must have seen my thumb." As opposed to
like when you do that when you do that joke.
Yeah, put your finger through his rounds. Yeah, I think he might. I can't imagine he would say he was just rearranging his balls. I think he might have been trying to shoplift some sausages. Probably makes more sense in a supermarket. I think so, shoplift sausages.
I think the idea is that he'd rather take the hit for shoplifting sausages than exposing his self in a supermarket. Yeah. Probably the lesser of the offence, which is probably why he that is the right answer. Well done.
Was a slight flaw in that he basically didn't have any sausages on him when they tried to stop him.
It was from the special sort of, you know, European sausages section.
From a delicatessen counter.
Yeah. Security in the supermarket has the worst crime they've seen committed in there. Anyway, so number 10, banned from Chinese buffet for A, attacking the staff with chopsticks, or B, shitting in the seaweed.
There's a lot of shitting stories here, aren't there? Yeah.
This is another quiz that we could do again one day, because this is just a small selection of them.
I wonder whether or not... I mean, they're both fairly feasible, aren't they? I mean, yeah, let's be honest, anything along these lines, sort of shitting anywhere, is kind of happens, and obviously you do have chopsticks in a Chinese buffet restaurant.
But one of them's fairly feasible, yes.
I think you're going to do shitting in the seaweed, I think.
Well done. Not sure how many you got right there. I think you probably got. I think the headlines just take away from what the actual score is anyway, but. If you want to have a quick Google online, Jeremy Corbyn sex dwarf, if you go onto the incognito tabs in your Google Chrome or whatever, if this was a certificate for being an associate fellow, that might be one of the things I may have written about, how to use incognito tabs.
Yeah.
Maybe.
Fair enough, I don't really make a great deal. So should we play the music on to the next part?
Yeah, anyway, see you in a bit. Thank you very much for listening, watching live, watching later, taking part, whatever you've been doing. I hope you've enjoyed this episode. We're going to be on episode 99 next.
99, yeah.
Which is...
You got some ice creams. That's some ice creams.
Oh, why did they call them 99? Because that's how much they cost.
I think, well, that's how much they used to cost, yeah, 99p.
Yeah.
I think...
$1.99. That was my certificate.
Oh, well, to be fair... fairly worthless anyway, isn't it, really? Yeah.
Part of seller management is about stacking and, you know, I failed that one already, so, yeah.
Yeah, looking after your product and being nice and neat and tidy. Yeah. So, yeah, I mean, the good news is that after the 17th of May, we'll be able to hug each other again.
We will.
Have you been looking forward to it, Jimbo?
No, not really. I'm not hugging you until you get that air sorted out.
Well, you'll not be able to get near me with this air, will you?
Don't know what Anne Hathaway will make of it. Not the one from the films.
So, to be fair, a lot of people talking about this. Oh, we'll be able to hug each other again. How many people do you hug?
No. Not a huggy person, really.
No, me neither. I can't recall anyone particularly who I hug. So I don't see that it's going to make much of a difference to me, really. Mm. But I think as of 17th of May, I believe we'll possibly be able to record next to each other. And so, no longer on Zoom.
So that means our 100th episode we're going to be doing in person, basically, isn't it?
Well, we do it in person, but yeah, we might not be via Skype. We might be recording live, but just in one location together.
Yeah.
Although we're not quite
sure. We could technically have 30 people in a garden as well, so we could have us and 28 audience members.
Mm. Yeah, should we maybe try and do a live episode of an audience?
Do you think we can get 28 people to watch it live? to actually attend and watch it live?
Well, probably not, but... yeah, we could think about trying to get a room somewhere.
Let's issue some golden tickets.
Yeah, that'd be good, wouldn't it? Mm. Get the fans out. Wonder who would attend it, if anyone. Mm. Yeah, but something to think about. See if we can find a live location. It's all the rage, isn't it, doing sort of live recordings of podcasts? That's what people do instead of like writing stand-up comedy shows. Just do a live recording of podcasts and stick it out.
Exactly. We'll think about it.
I mean, yeah. I mean, if we start doing live episodes, I might even make it onto the podcast list of recommended podcasts from our work.
Exactly. And it probably won't be the most disappointing thing you've ever watched live, particularly if you're a Sheffield Wednesday fan.
Of course.
So get yourselves down.
I actually watched the game on Saturday. Mm. And, you know, we were never staying up, were we, I don't think?
I'm not sure about that. I think there might have been about 5 seconds where we were, which was just as they were kicking the penalty into the net.
Yeah.
Rotherham's conceded.
Yeah. So there was a very short period.
The fact that, you know, you've got a team who, you know, we needed to do a job, and that was just win the game. Because, you know, we could have gone down for winning or losing. It don't really matter. We just needed to win. That's all we had to do. The rest was out of our hands. And on two occasions, we were winning. We were winning a game of football on two occasions. They have to... It's just like it had to be done. They had to throw it away. It doesn't matter what... No, they're going to try and win, but they're still going to try and throw it away as well. I don't want to get into it because it's frustrating. Yeah.
But anyway. He scored 3 goals, but still didn't win. I mean, that's quite... I mean, to be fair to Derby, they want to win as well. So.
Yeah.
And they didn't. They drew. And I do actually feel a little bit sorry for Rotherham.
Yeah, I do.
And who possibly actually slightly least deserved
it. I would have rather have Rotherham stayed up than Derby, and Derby come down with us. And that's and Rotherham fans won't say the same about Sheffield Wednesday, unfortunately. Yeah. It's a weird relationship we have. But but the thing is, you know that Rotherham are going to be in the top six of League One next year. You know that. You could put your money on Rotherham being in the top six in League One next year. I know we've turned into a football podcast now, but could you put your money on Sheffield Wednesday being in the top six of League One next year?
Don't know. Let's go to Andy Townsend and tactics truck. What have you got, Andy? Let's look at how Sheffield Wednesday's playing, how they're doing. I don't know. I mean, to be fair, the chairman said he had a plan a few years ago to get Sheffield Wednesday out of the Championship, and he's eventually done it. So well done.
He's taken full responsibility, hasn't he, for the performance, and then he's going to sack his assistant.
Yeah.
No, we're joking.
He's going to... Someone said taxi for Chanzieri, but it turns out that the taxi firm that it's set up doesn't actually have any taxis.
Oh, right. Okay. Anyway, let's have faith. Right, let's get going, shall we? So we'll see you again, hopefully next week for episode 99, and then episode 100 coming up very soon. Thank you for listening, watching. Tweet us at Wasted Web Space, Facebook, Instagram, website, all that sort of stuff. Ta-ra.
See you soon. Bye.